have readers, something the industry has been struggling to hold on to. This has been a horrible year for the newspaper business, with layoffs and buyouts and cutbacks and sinking revenue and all kinds of dire predictions about the future. So we decided to call in three of the top editors in the business to examine why newspapers are hurting, what can be done about it, and what is the impact on aggressive reporting. Joining us now in San Francisco, Phil Bronstein, who ran two newspapers for 16 years, first as editor of the San Francisco Examiner, and then, until last January, the San Francisco Chronicle. In Chicago, Jim Warren, who until August was managing editor of the Chicago Tribune. And here in the studio, Leonard Downey, who stepped down in September after 17 years as executive editor of the Washington Post. Bronstein, before we get into the internet or the lousy economy, to what extent are newspapers suffering from self-inflicted wounds caused by years of complacency?
Well, whose complacency were we talking about? Were we talking about readers' complacency, Howie? Were we talking about reporters' complacency? You know, I think there's been a long time, over decades, separation of newsrooms from the public. You know, there's a sort of an apocryphal story of the reporter who says, I can't take that call from a reader, I'm too busy doing journalism. So it really depends on whose complacency you're talking about. I think newspapers and newsrooms have been very complacent. And, you know, I not to be heretical here, but I think there ought to be some newspapers that probably should shut down just because they're not doing it the right way. They're not paying attention. They're not as connected with readers. I mean, newspapers used to do the things that the web wants to do, which is aggregate content and create community. And I think there's been much less of that going on.
Jim Warren, I wrote a book 15 years ago called Media Circus, in which I argued the newspapers at that time were too dull, too incremental, too cautious, and written too much for insiders. Would you agree that that has been part of the problem?
You know, to a certain extent, but it's a big marketplace out there. And the fact that not everybody apes the Washington Post and the New York Times is not necessarily all that bad. I mean, for sure, this has not only been a bad year, it's arguably been the worst year in the history of the business. Publicly traded newspaper-based companies, their share prices have gone down something like 80%. That's far worse than the Standard & Poor's 500 average over the past year. So you've got a dramatic fall in revenues, dramatic fall in profitability. Some of these companies, like a lot of the Wall Street firms, way, way, way too highly leveraged. That said, what one of the more interesting things out there, one of the more interesting realities, guys, is the fact that if you take the whole universe of readership in some of these communities of a paper like the Washington Post, combining the print version with the online version, you probably have had audiences which have never been bigger than they are today. Yes, the Post circulation heading a little bit south, but when you add in the number of folks who are looking at your great journalism, that's a pretty impressive figure. Now the question is, how do you make money, particularly off the internet? And right now, that is a severe challenge.
Let me ask the former editor of the Washington Post, Len Downey. Certainly, the internet has provided a whole new audience for lots of papers, including the Post. But at the same time, the staff has been shrinking because of the financial situation. Why didn't most newspapers realize earlier what trouble they were headed for? Why didn't a newspaper company create a popular website like the Huffington Post or Politico?
Well, in fact, the Washington Post and the New York Times and a number of other newspapers have created very popular websites. Huffington Post and Politico don't come near us in page views. We have much, much larger audiences. And the top 10 news sites on the web are dominated by the so-called old media companies, including CNN and NBC and the Washington Post and the New York Times. So people are reading our journalism in larger numbers than ever before. It's having more impact than ever before. But in terms of the business model, yes, we were way behind. We were complacent. It was an industry that was a copycat industry where everybody did the same thing all the time. Television's the same way, where you've got the consultants out there telling every television station how to behave all the time.
And everyone was making money, and so it seemed to be working.
Everybody was making lots of money. And the newsrooms got really big. I have to say that for some newsrooms that have contracted, the contraction does not yet hurt that much. For other newsrooms that were already smaller, the contractions hurt quite a bit.
And with all these cutbacks, Phil Bronstein, whether it's the Detroit papers eliminating home delivery several days a week to your own San Francisco Chronicle, which has had about 200 or so layoffs and buyouts, and sections being cut, aren't newspapers now gutting the very product they're trying to sell?
Well, I think they're responding to the economic issues. I mean, the reality is the Washington Post, I mean, not to step into Len Downey's own territory there, but the Washington Post is surviving and maybe even thriving because it's got a business, Kaplan's, that's, I think, more than 50% of its business that has nothing to do with journalism. And I think so you get diversified, you know, you might survive. But the news business as we know it is not surviving financially, economically. And so I think, you know, there's a big problem with the newsprint product. Mort Rosenblum, who you know, our old friend from AP, said the other day, you know, we don't, it's not that we don't love Google, but we want to maintain Gutenberg. And the problem is hanging on to that printed version. Yes, things are going to shrink, newsrooms are going to shrink, sections are going to shrink. But as Jim Warren said, you know, you have a bigger audience out there. What are you going to do to attract that audience? By the way, there are also other financial models that are very interesting. ProPublica struggling a little bit, but that's privately funded investigative reporting. Mort Rosenblum is doing something called Dispatches.
Let me go to Jim because I want to pick up the point about the financial models. Tribune is bankrupt. This, of course, is a company that owns the Chicago Tribune, Los Angeles Times, Baltimore Sun, other papers, and TV stations. Now, the tendency has been to blame it on Sam Zell, the Chicago zillionaire who bought it a year ago and loaded it up with $13 billion worth of debt. But weren't there also years of mismanagement that brought the paper to the point where it had to be sold to a Sam Zell?
Well, I mean, I think there were probably years of a certain myopia that was industry-wide, particularly the failure to embrace the Internet, particularly the failure to deal with sky-high production costs, particularly the failure to maintain ridiculously, to me, low pricing levels. I mean, to get a home-delivered newspaper in a plastic bag for far less than it would cost me to go out to the 7-Eleven, I think was a distinct mistake. I think in the case of Zell, you've got to remember, in fairness, there was essentially a public auction of the company, which nobody bid for this company. It's got 25 TV stations and about 10 newspapers. So he came in and made the best possible deal that he could. But when it comes to models from this point on, I mean, I think the two main ones that people are throwing out are the one that Phil alluded to, ProPublica, for which people who don't know is sort of you go to some rich philanthropists and get some money from them and exploit that, sort of an NPR model. But the other one, which I think hopefully in a free marketplace can somehow survive, is the one in which you get people to pay for this information. Len just alluded to all these websites which are doing so well, including CNN's. Where does that content generally come from? Most of it comes from newspapers, and they're not paying for it. They've been ripping newspapers off, and newspapers have sat back and allowed that and now go, oh, my gosh, that's unfair.
Yeah, well, I want to pick that up in a second, but let me ask you first, Len Downey. As you know, a lot of big papers and big paper newspaper companies are closing their Washington bureaus, are really gutting them. I mean, you have Newhouse Newspapers, Cox Newspapers, San Diego Union Tribune, no more D.C. Bureau. The Tribune has combined this bureau with the L.A. Times, was that of the L.A. Times, the Baltimore Sun, and others. Some people say, well, maybe that makes sense because you had too many reporters in D.C. writing the same stories anyway. What do you think?
Well, with the Internet, of course, you can get everybody's reporting anywhere in the country. So you can get the New York Times or the Washington Post coverage if your local newspaper no longer covers Washington. But I am concerned that as all newsrooms contract, that the broad number of subjects that need to be covered in Washington won't be covered. I think we saw that towards the end of this administration where we all suddenly looked at, well, what happened to HUD during this administration? What happened to the FDA? Suddenly we were giving catch-up stories about problems that exist in these agencies. Now Obama's going to come in. The Obama administration will come in. They're going to re-regulate in a lot of areas. They're going to be doing a lot of really new things. And are we going to be there to watch whether they're doing the right new things, whether the changes will benefit the country or not? I'm worried we're not going to have enough reporters in all those agencies.
Right. Washington Journalism is not just doing a stand-up in front of the White House. Phil Bronstein, do we pay too much attention to newspaper layoffs and buyouts at a time when, you know, major banks and other companies are laying off tens of thousands of people? And will the impact on original reporting, the kind of Len Downey just talked about, be as great as we say, or will other media forces, citizen journalists, websites be able to pick up this slack?
Well, first of all, you know, I think that even when newsrooms were pretty flush a few years ago, I mean, we were missing big stories. We missed the first savings and loan collapse. A lot of controversy about the coverage of the original war in Iraq. I mean, I think that, you know, we've always been missing stories, and maybe that's to some extent the complacency that you're talking about. But I do think, I'm glad you mentioned citizen journalism. I mean, this has been a taboo subject almost in newsrooms. And the idea of comments on stories that appear on our websites have been this afterthought. But the reality is, I think one of the ways that we get our professionalism out there and professional journalism and maintain it and perhaps find a business model is by engaging more with the audience. So the real question is, what is that pro-am relationship?
Right.
What kind of relationship are professionals and citizens, in other words, amateur journalists, if you want to call them that, what kind of relationship are they going to have that's going to further engage those citizens, those residents, that audience?
Okay, I got to get a break here.
Yeah.
It has to be more of a two-way dialogue. For too many years, newspapers are engaged in sort of one-way communication. When we come back, we'll ask our editors about the coverage of the Gaza conflict and whether it has been fair.